And you started kind of working as a handyman and helper, and I know that you'd done some remodeling of stores and storefronts, and so you started to make a living as well.
To make a living. The pottery folded when my money got low. It was kind of difficult. We were all kind of struggling, and so I got a job at Arkansas Primitives, which was making furniture out of old barn wood.
Mm-hmm.
And so I worked there until it folded. But at that time, I'd made that trip up to Omaha, Nebraska, and I'd gotten a shop smith, and I brought it down, and and I started accumulating tools. I bought a router on credit at Sears. I bought a table saw and jointer, and I lived in a apartment that was so small that you could literally shit, shave, shower, and stir the beans all at the same time. And next door was the attached garage, and so I framed across the front of the garage because there was no door. I built a door, I enclosed it, and that became my wood shop.
Mm.
I can't talk about Eureka Springs without talking about the arts community and the encouraging and inclusive nature of it, and how and how it is such a reinforcement to be involved in a community where there's respect for the arts and there are fellow artists to commiserate with or to encourage you. And it, before my early, my pre-Eureka life, I mentioned I'd only known one craftsman. And here I know so many artists and craftsmen that they're more or less than of anyone else in terms of areas of engagement.
Right, right. Well, yeah, as you've described your life, Doug, I'm just so aware that the path that you've followed is so much like the paths that many of the folks who live around here followed. I mean, it's almost as though folks were destined to come and live here in the Ozarks.
The thing that some of us used to... we used to talk about the world outside Eureka as being something different from the world inside Eureka. And some of my associates back in the hippie days thought that everything out there was kind of unsustainable, and at some point things would fall apart, and where would people want to go? And that would be Eureka, because this was a place where people could actually take care of each other and care for each other. And some of us actually had expressed the idea that all the motels that we have here now are because we could possibly need those hotels at some point to help people to move back to the land and back to a more conscientious understanding of the world we live in. And in a way, in kind of a strange way, we seem to have done that, because I think that Eureka Springs offers up a role model for what community can really be, where people are craftsmen and artists and making an effort to live local, live considerate to the environment. And I think that there's that possibility of us serving without the economy having completely collapsed and everybody filling up our hotel rooms.
Right, right. Along the way, Doug, you kind of revisited that early advice that people were giving you about being a writer. And you started writing, and now the author of, as you said, 7 books. I actually own 3 of your books, and I found one of the three, extremely useful in my own work.
Thank you.
Yeah. The other two are less useful, just because I'm less skilled than I need to be. But
or maybe don't have quite the tools and haven't had the time to invest in those procedures.
Yeah, the one of the things that I'm aware of in reading your books, and I'm talking specifically about a book called Rustic Furniture Basics. And then the other book that I have and have used of yours was Basic Box Making. But what I'm in touch with both of those books is that they are it's much about philosophy and about thinking about wood and thinking about work as they are how-to books. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, Jean-Jacques Rousseau had said, I'm kind of twisting things a little bit, putting things into my own words, or actually going to a Swedish translation of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Swedish from the French into English.
Okay.
Because this doesn't come across exactly the same way if you're reading it direct, but he said, put a young man in a wood shop, his hands work to the benefit of his brain and becomes a philosopher while thinking himself only a craftsman.
Ah.
And so you cannot work with wood or clay or, you know, any other material without engaging the intellect or any day. You know.
There you go.
And there is a thing that I've found in my woodworking that some of the process has become routine. For example, if I'm making 50 boxes, there are 5-7 operations done to the front, mm-hmm. 9 to the back, 3 to each end, and that's before assembly. And so you can see that there's an opportunity for some mindlessness in all of that, you know, the mind wandering. But
right.
The wandering mind is not necessarily being mindless. You know, you are drawing on other things. You're observing, and you may be observing the process, thinking about how you would refine it, or you may be thinking about something else.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the opportunities that I have in being self-employed is that I can be very impulsive in what I do.
Mm.
And so, if I'm standing there processing parts, and suddenly that word comes into play that's essential for something I'm trying to say,
mm-hmm.
then I can put the parts aside and I go to the computer and I can write my thoughts down, and I may spend 15 or 20 minutes doing a blog post on it, and then I'm back right. to the shop. And so maybe I should say there are four things, you know, four important things, the gifts. The one is being self-employed.
Sure.
Or maybe that just goes with the craft.
Well, I have myself been an owner or self-employed person for more than 35 years, and it's basically because I learned early on that I'd be a very poor employee. And Doug, before we conclude our conversation, and I see just from how much stuff we've been talking about here that we'll need to have you back sometime. I hope you'll agree to do that.
I'd love to.
But I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about the future of craft in America. You and I had an earlier conversation about stugas, the small houses that Norwegian and Swedish craftsmen would make, and the rose mauling, and some of those very artistic and useful household items that people used that combined that beauty, form, and function all as one. And I'm contrasting that conversation with a visit I played earlier this month to an IKEA store in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. We were up visiting our daughter who's going to school up there. And the same Swedes, those same
the good folks, designers.
Yes, and it's wonderful stuff.
Yeah.
But it's all mass-produced.
Yeah.
Talk to me a little bit about that.
Well, I think we're kind of going in the wrong direction on a lot of things, and maybe that's one reason why Eureka Springs is important and living in a community of craftsmen. Someone to tell a different opposing view. I 6 out of 10 children this year, the top item on their wish list was an iPad.
Right. Right.
And you see, if you go online, you see children laying on their mother's beds, mothers and fathers' beds, playing with the iPhone. And so the child's 5 or 6 months old. And, and you know, when I grew up, we played with string. We played with scissors. We were cutting things out using manual dexterity.
And probably ran with scissors.
And we ran with scissors. And, and we were painting and making messes. I met an artist at a conference, and I had told my viewpoint about the wisdom of the hands and how children need to be engaged in hands-on learning. And she said, you know, I bought woodworking tools for my grandson, and his mother wouldn't let them in the house.
Mm.
She was afraid he would injure something, a piece of furniture. You know, it's like parents not letting their children have crayons because they might mark on the wall. But, you know, if you're a loving parent, at some point you look at those marks that your child left on the wall with a sense of love.
Yeah. We have been talking with Doug Stowe, a self-described woodworker, but actually, in my view, a woodworking genius. He is a columnist and author. Just has published a new book called Building Small Cabinets. It's available from Taunton Press. You can find it on Amazon.com and better bookstores everywhere. I encourage you to visit Doug Stowe at his website, dougstowe.com, and you can find out all about Doug's other books and so on. Doug, thank you so much for being with us today here on the Ozark Harvest Radio Hour.
Thank you, Dan. Thanks for having me on.
That's our show for the week. We hope you've enjoyed it. Next week, water activist Barbara Harmony, isn't that a lovely name, provides us with our founding mother's and father's interview. Jill Stice tells us all about children's gardens and how they work. Richard Pillay will entertain us with some witty and pungent poetry, including the turbid tap water dance. We'll probably dish up another story of all the news from Berryville, and we'll have some sound advice for folks about who to vote for and why. The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is a production of Carroll County Fresh. Carroll County Fresh thanks writer and producer Dan Croats, Dr. Sharon Sloan, Director of Technology, Dr. Fred Mayer, Music Director, Richard Pillay, reporter and editorialist. Mary Hyatt, national spokesperson for Living Better Without Chemistry. The board of directors of Carroll County Fresh, Jane Pillay, president, Andrew Schwerin, John Toombs, and Judy Turner, members. We thank St. Fiacre, patron saint of gardeners, and program theologian. And you, our listeners, thank you so much for tuning in. The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is organic radio, not always perfect, not always pretty, but always fresh, local, and honest. Until next week, go out and grow something.
One, two, three, four.